We'll need an ambulance. Our friend here shot himself. He's got a Luger under his coat. This bloke shouldn't trouble us for a few minutes, but there's another couple over there in the car yard who could be a problem any second. Perhaps if I took the Luger.
Perhaps not.
Jill!
Please, Don.
Come on.
Don, please. Me home now, will you please go? I'd like my key back, and I want you to leave. I'm going to bed.
Who with?
Don't be stupid. I've got the flu. What do you want?
Who's the bloke you've been bringing here?
I haven't brought anyone.
Stop lying.
Don, you're hurting me. Don!
Who's the old bloke?
Why should you care who he is? I don't mean anything to you. It could be me or any other girl. I don't think you'd know one from the other in the dark.
Have you finished? What's your game with him?
Nothing.
Does that mean you like him?
I can't stand him.
Well, what's your game? What are you after?
He's got a jewellery shop. I went in there 2 months ago to get me watch fixed.
So he fixed your watch. What next?
I need money.
That makes you the exception. Other people don't.
You know why I wanted it. Don, I can't even stand him touching me, but...
But what?
For a long time, each time he saw me, he'd just make some little remark.
Each time you dropped in with your watch?
Yeah. And then one day I said my mother was sick.
And he offered to pay the doctor's bills?
Yeah.
How much does a doctor cost?
You said we could be married if we had the money for a house.
How stupid can you get?
I'm not stupid. Please don't.
I should have told the police everything.
What's everything?
Well, Jill had a date to meet some old man.
I thought that was it. Who was he?
You'd better tell me. He killed her. Haven't you tumbled to that yet?
Could have been a prowler.
Yeah, well, you let the cops work it out. And keep your mouth shut. Did you ever meet him?
No.
He's a jeweler, isn't he?
I don't know.
Come on, she couldn't keep anything to herself.
I don't know.
Look, that old man gave her a watch studded with diamonds. The cops have got it now.
I never saw it. Don't! You're hurting me. Don't.
Tell me the name of that jeweler.
I can't. Don't even know if he was a jeweler.
Look, you've got to help me. Those crummy cops think I killed your girlfriend.
I can't.
Tell me his name, where he lives, and where his shop is.
No, I don't want to help you.
You have to. Now what?
We've received some information from Miss Henderson's mother. We'd like to question you again.
Look, why don't you lay off me? And find her boyfriend. This could have been used to strangle her.
Is there any indication she was strangled?
Not as far as I know.
Well, just for that, you can cover the post-mortem. Find out how she did die.
Yes, sir. You know, I don't see any great mystery here.
Oh?
From what I've heard, there's this thing on between the school committee and Laughing Boy.
Yeah?
Simple. The committee sent down their most attractive member, Anne Elliot, to charm the old boy into line. But he treats her with scorn.
He does.
Mm. And hell hath no fury like a lady with a lighter.
And we let her slip through our fingers.
Mm. Of course, we've got to prove it yet.
How did you like your first post-mortem?
It wasn't the first, sir, but they don't get any better.
No. What did you find out?
Well, it's not conclusive yet. They're running further tests. But there's a head injury that could have been caused before the fire.
Mm. What's that?
A forensic distilled it from the ashes.
Petrol?
Near enough. Mineral terps.
You don't mind. We're trying to solve a baffling crime in there.
Well, let me unbaffle you a little. Forensic and pathological investigations into the death of Alice Mary Donaldson show that death was due to asphyxiation in the presence of extreme heat. There is no indication of prior physical assault.
Well, maybe she lit it herself or caused it accidentally.
Or simply discovered it and tried to put it out.
Yeah. Did you find out why she was at the school so late?
Yeah, she left around about 6 with Mrs. Rogers. They had tea together, but then she went back to the school to pick up her umbrella.
So nobody would have known she'd be there.
Well,
that seems to rule out the planned assault. Do you know who gave the alarm yet?
No, but we know which alarm was used. Sir, I was.
I've got a job for you.
Well, that's good.
What meeting?
It's a special one on account of the fire.
Really? Where's it to be?
I thought at my place. Save you the worry.
It'll be less worry if we have it at my place. In fact, I insist.
How's it going with Donald Joe? What's his name? You know, the old fellow's on the mission.
No, a waste of time. Here's something more to the point.
What's that?
A full report on my lunchtime session.
Session?
At the freeway inn.
No wonder it's a full report. What did you find out?
Norm Jenkins was drinking there most of last evening. Except for a half an hour around about 7 o'clock.
Well, see now.
Time to get over to the school and back.
I don't know, all these alibis we're getting on with a bumper. Bill and I wasted half the day chasing up Anne Elliot to check on hers.
She wasn't at home, she wasn't at work, but we hope to see her tonight.
School committee's having a special meeting.
I'm not surprised.
Why is that?
It fits my theory. They're planning the next fire. Well, I'll tell you something else.
Go on.
Melbourne beer's not as bad as you might think it is.
Do another one?
Oh, here. As long as it's a pot.
And then we'll check this whole damn crowd again.
Senior Detective Peter Barnes of Homicide. For outstanding bravery displayed whilst defusing a live bomb, the Valor Award.
We've got a double murder on our hands. Mickey Nash and an unknown associate were shot to death at a farm just this side of Monbulk. I've had a talk to Stella Nash and her son, but if they know anything, they're not letting on. No word from Mac?
No, I just got back.
We're trying to locate the weapon and identify the second man. If Mac phones in, put the call through to me.
Right.
Peter, you'd better sit at that desk in the future.
Redford. Peter Barnes, the boss asked me to pick you up.
How'd you know me?
You look like you could use a drink.
No, I'll be all right.
Come on, I've done a few of these myself, mate. What you need is a pick-me-up.
What will the inspector say?
Well, who's going to tell him?
Where the hell have you been?
Well, we,
I checked with the mortuary. You left there over 40 minutes ago. It doesn't take that long to get here. You can walk it in 20 minutes.
That would be a very fast walk, sir.
The autopsy report, sir?
There's nothing much in there. They both died of gunshot wounds, which we already knew.
At approximately 10 p.m. last night, we didn't know that.
No, sir.
I tell you something else we still don't know. The identity of the second man. Sergeant Mackay is working on a possible lead. I want you and Senior Redford to check out every one of Mickey Nash's known associates. He's definitely been connected with the Federal Bank holdup. There's $86,000 missing. Ample motive for a double murder, don't you agree?
Oh, yes, sir.
Yes, and there's something else. You two have been celebrating. You stopped off somewhere for a drink.
I know, sir.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, well, sort of.
It was my fault, sir.
Every one of Mickey Nash's known associates checked out today. I don't care if it takes you until midnight.
Yes, sir.
His bark's worse than his bite.
So what's it like to be bitten?
They'd have forgotten all about it by the time we get back.
When'll that be?
About midnight.
I've got lectures at night.
You've got them during the day, too. I hadn't you noticed. You get used to it.
I hope so. Don't want to get thrown out of Homicide on my first day.
Well, that would be a record, you know. It's never happened before.
Thanks.
Stick with me, pal. I'll see you right.
Like this morning?
Worried about something, copper.
Pal?
I think I just want to sit here for a minute.
I can't get anything out of them, sir.
Why'd they clear out?
Oh, antisocial, I suppose. And they'd had just enough to drink to make them game.
I know exactly what you mean, Peter. All right, leave him to me. You and Phil check out the rest of Mickey's mates.
Right, sir.
Peter, how's he shaping up?
All right, I suppose.
Well, will he make a homicide detective or not?
That's a bit early to tell. There is one thing, sir.
What's that?
He doesn't seem to be terribly handy with his fists.
He ducked into a couple of punches. We've all done that from time to time.
He wasn't throwing many in return.
He doesn't believe in violence. It's a legacy from Vietnam.
Well, with all due respect, sir, you could get hurt that way.
Yeah. We'll keep an eye on him. Take him under your wing. We don't want any more accidents. Thanks, Peter.
Anything from Mac?
Not yet.
take those. And I'll take this as well. On second thoughts, you can drive. Russell Street Police Headquarters.
All right, Sergeant, you can get dressed now. When did the pain start?
8 weeks ago. About 8 weeks ago.
And the tiredness? Throughout the same time?
Yes, that's been getting worse, Doctor.
They've been working you too hard, I suppose.
Shouldn't I have tests or something?
What for?
My father died of cancer.
Oh, good heavens, is that what's worrying you?
It's a thought.
Forget it.
The pain fits.
It fits a lot of things. Like worrying about cancer, for example. Any other worries? Look, if it sets your mind at rest, I'll arrange for you to have tests.
Thank you.
You've had time to think.
Sorry?
About this transfer business. You've thought it over?
Yes, I haven't changed my mind.
I don't understand you, Peter.
I just think I'd be better off elsewhere, that's
all. You wouldn't, you know. I mean, blokes who move because of some gripe, well, you know as well as I do what happens. You'd stay a sergeant the rest of your career.
I'm going to stay a sergeant anyway. That's as far as I'm going to get.
All right.
Come on, get away from me.
McHeathcote, she was his girlfriend.
I don't give a damn. She shouldn't have been touched, and you ought to know better. Take him back to your car or something. Just get him away from here.
Come on, Mick.
$226. What? Stiff number 226. You give them numbers like in extermination camps. Tattoos on the wrists. It's easier than names. With names you might remember that they're people.
Yeah.
What I'm talking about. You think I'm an unfeeling bastard?
I didn't say that.
No, I can see it. It's a policy for survival, son. Once you start feeling things in this job, thinking things, you're gone, finished, understand?
No.
No, well, you've only been in the job 5 minutes. Give it time, you know what I mean? You can't afford to. They're on the watch for that sort of thing. It's the weakness is that it's a black mark against you. Can't say that I blame them in this job, though. God, if you started, you'd be crying till kingdom come. Perhaps they're the lucky ones, your wife and your daughter. We still have to live with it, don't we?
What?
The rottenness, like the man who killed your daughter. What sort of a person do you think he'd be?
I don't know.
An animal, her boyfriend said, a wild animal. Do you think that?
He'd have to be, wouldn't he?
Yes. Of course, you wouldn't see it, not from the outside. Could be a good bloke. Family man, perhaps. Respectable job, well thought of. Smiling face, wanting the world to like him. But inside, that's a different story. Inside's dirty and furtive. Dirty thoughts festering. Frightened him sometimes, these thoughts. Not often. Because they were only thoughts. Until last night. Last night it all happened.
I don't see the point.
He was frightened when he killed your daughter. He struck at her again and again. He was savage with her, savage with himself.
Just penetrating the lungs and ribcage.
She died quickly.
All in good time, Sergeant. Call this number 3, Jeff. Oh, yes, interesting. Deflected off the ileum, penetrating the large intestine. Oh, the bone chip teasing.
Oh, for God's sake. Let's have some dignity.
You're all right, Sergeant.
Well, she's not just a bloody object. Death should have some dignity.
Tell him he's got a very sick sergeant.
know. It's a bloody nervous breakdown.
You had the answer.
Why me?
Because you loved her, didn't you?
Yes.
Father and daughter loved her like your own, her boyfriend said.
No, not like that. You know. You bloody know. You've been playing games with me. You knew this morning. You know I killed her. God help me.
It must have been one of the shortest trials on record.
Young pleaded guilty, didn't he?
Yeah, he got life. Didn't seem to care too much. I don't think he was really interested in what happened to it. His wife died 8 weeks back.
Been out of touch.
Yeah, but you're okay now.
Oh, yeah, they washed my mind with soapy water.
Well, what do I tell the boss? When are you coming back to us?
I'm not, Pat. Enough's enough.
Still putting in your transfer or what?
No, I think I'll get out altogether. Quit the force.
Sure?
Yeah.
Well, you made sergeant pretty quick, homicide squad. On your way to the top, I'd reckon.
No, not after this. There'd always be a question mark against me. I sometimes wonder myself.
Do they say you're cured, mate? Well, what are you gonna do?
Oh, I don't know. Perhaps I'm not too old to study up a bit, like Phil. Teach, maybe.
School teacher?
Yeah, why not, if I can qualify?
Find the job a bit tame after this one, mate.
Maybe. I just want to see another side of life, that's all. I mean, you'd done other things before you joined the force. Fishing, you were on fishing boats, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, I was practically straight out of high school into a police cadet uniform, which was fine at first. Exciting, made you feel important. But lying back there in bed these last few weeks, I got to thinking that that's about all I've seen, that side of life. The muck we handle day in and day out. Till you begin to wonder whether there are any other kind of people in the world. Have you got to go?
Oh, no, no hurry. Is the fella going to give me some information about that bank job in Altona?
You see, you know that the job isn't everything. That the whole world isn't like that. I just got to get out and see things from the outside. Because, quite honestly, mate, from where I've been seeing them from the inside, it all looks pretty hopeless.
What the hell's going on?
Darling, what's wrong?
The trouble, Gary Burke just missed an entrance.
I didn't know you were back tonight.
I wasn't. Now, what was all that about?
What do you mean?
You missed an entrance.
Yeah, well, I had a spot of trouble.
What kind of trouble?
Well, Well, how the hell did I know she was only 15?
Would you care?
Oh, you're really putting the boot in, aren't you?
I damn well wish I could. If I had my way, Buster, I'd boot you right off this channel. Why are you still wearing a school uniform?
I haven't been home.
Do your parents know where you are?
I don't have any.
Who looks after you?
Oh, nobody much.
Well, there must be someone.
I live with my auntie.
Why did you do it?
Oh, I wonder what it'd be like.
Now, don't you try and claim you're a virgin.
Oh, I wasn't. But you see, some of the girls at school were talking about TV stars, and I thought I'd try one. Oh, I don't know why you're getting uptight.
No, you probably don't.
I'm not going to tell anyone if that's what you're worried about.
I'll tell you what I'm worried about, young lady. I'm not sure why, but you have tricked Mr. Burke into committing a very serious criminal offense. Ta-da! Oh.
Sorry, love. It said Mr. Donovan on the door. You're Jean Ford. I'm Lee Whiteman.
Oh, Mr. Donovan's expecting you.
Oh, don't worry with all that triz.
Don't blow your brains out. The station is safe.
Lee, you bloody old man, it's good to see you.
Naturally. Oh, you great butch bastard. You don't have to impress me, you know.
Jean, could you wrestle up Mrs. Hopkins? sit down, sit down. When'd you get in?
Oh, 9:30.
Have you been to the motel?
Oh, yes, just dropped off my things there. Thought I'd better dash straight over and see what disasters awaited me.
Yes, there are one or two problems. Donovan.
That's nice. Where'd you get it?
If I may ask.
Am I happy being formal?
No, well, I just suddenly thought it might be a gift from a sultan for services rendered.
A friend of mine made it. It's one of the first. She made me another one, too. It's beautiful.
Well, where is it?
In my room.
Well, could I see it? Is that it?
Do you like it?
Yeah. It's marvelous.
Something stupid, I could kick myself. I thought the best way to sort out how I felt about you was to put it down in writing. You know, try and analyze it. So I wrote you a letter. I don't suppose I would have sent it. I had second thoughts even before I finished it. Anyway, it's been stolen.
Now, you see what I mean? We need somewhere where we can get out with the evidence in case anything happens.
Well, nothing's gonna happen. I got broken paid.
It's not him we gotta worry about. It's Constable Greed. Now, listen, I reckon that if we build a trapdoor over by that table somewhere...
And another one leading from the back of the shed...
Yeah, then we'd be safe.
Well, Mrs. Moran would be real happy to see us all go tearing through a kitchen.
It wouldn't be through a kitchen, it would be through the yard near the back door.
Well, maybe I can fix it up. Anyway, I'll see you later. Right. I'll call in about 10 o'clock tonight. Barney, you're in charge. Any trouble with the pencil, get Jim here to give you a hand. Don't know what we'd do without his head for figures.
Well, how about 6 months in Pentridge?
What?
For God's sake, Jack, I've just been trying to tell you. Jim Tracy got 6 months. Ryan and Cohen, too. The beef put them all in the slot without option. Not that I suppose that'd worry you, because the poor bastard was going to leave anyway.
What'd he get fined?
Well, he got 6 bloody months. And what do you reckon, Jack? Do you still want to go on with this? Because if you want my opinion, this is a mug's game, and we are the mugs for working here.
You really don't care, do you, about what I think about my views?
Look, Pam, do we have to go over all this territory again on my first day back?
Go your own way.
It's my job, my career.
Career?
I can't just walk away from it because I stopped a stray bullet.
You could have been killed. Gail!
It was my own fault. I got careless.
Well, I hate it. It's dangerous and it's all so grotty.
It was what I do.
Lousy rat-fink cop. Bye, Dad.
Bye-bye, sweetheart.
You won't get into any sessions with your cronies.
Perish the thought.
Tom Foster and O'Reilly and all those other charming chavvies.
Bye-bye.
G'day, Glenn. How you feeling?
I'm in good shape, mate.
What about some service?
Listen, I'll catch up with you later. You shouldn't have gone to all that trouble. Now, how long did it take, by the way?
Oh, it was all done the weekend, Sarge.
Oh, I bet it was, yeah.
How's the shoulder, Glenn?
It's good, thanks, mate. At least they didn't get me drinking arm.
I'll have to put it to the test after work.
You bet, mate. How's Mademoiselle Danielle?
Fine, Sergeant. Good to see you.
Good. Well, okay, thanks, everybody.
Come here.
You'd have a bit of a chat.
Okay, let's do that.
Mind if I sit in?
Help you.
Well, we better get this paperwork cleaned up, Tom. I was supposed to be having lunch with the DDI. Oh, yeah, how are we going with this payroll job?
The DDI, eh? Have one for me.
Yeah, I said, how are we going with the payroll job?
You'd better check with Don McKenna.
And why is it everything I mention you say check with McKenna or Johnson? Where have you been, on the golf course?
Look, if you don't like the way I've run the place, you can shove it. Just get off my back, huh? I've been on the force longer than you have, and I've been shot at, stabbed, mugged. The only difference is I don't get it on the front page, and I don't get promotion.
And what's bitten you all of a sudden?
Oh, I've had it.
Had what?
Everything.
Well, come on, let's talk about it. I mean, why take it out of me? We're supposed to be mates.
I don't have any mates.
Is it a woman?
I don't have a woman. I don't even have a wife. She died, you may recall.
Well, how's your boy? How's Gary?
Look, is there anything else you want to talk to me about?
Tony, what the hell are you doing in here?
I've just been talking to the chief clerk of the consorting squad about this fella Douglas, or Peter Douglas, or whatever he calls himself.
You're supposed to be off duty.
Oh, I was just talking to a few friends.
All right, who's it been associating with that we should know about?
Well, for one, a Charlie Simpson.
Charlie Simpson? The big head who never knows anything about anything. What doesn't he know anything about now?
Get him in here and find out.
There's another guy who's been associating with Douglas recently, named John Chadwick.
Now, there's a name to whet a cop's appetite. Supposed to be the brain behind some of the biggest bank jobs in town. So far, we haven't been able to pin a thing on him. Maybe that's all about to change. I'll get Don to follow that up, JJ. Can you get Simpson in here within the hour?
Do it blindfolded.
And no...
I'm on the wagon, Glenn.
How's Joe?
Oh, a bit better, thanks, sir. Still in a lot of pain.
Well, thanks for the information, Tony. Now, get the hell out of here, right?
Yes, sir.
Well, guess I'm finished for now.
Yes, I think we're both finished, Don. Listen, thanks for coming in. I know it was your day off, but I think it'll be worth it.
Well, if we can get Chadwick and the guy who bashed Joel Martin, it's been well worth it.
Yeah. Oh, if things happen, they'll probably start happening quickly, so stay by your telephone. No playing golf. You'd resent anyone who came between you and your precious father.
Oh, that sheer fantasy. I'm concerned with what happens to him.
You're concerned with who runs his life. Now, look, why do you think he resents me so much? It's not because I'm a lowly cop. It's because I came between the all-loving, all-possessive Edmund Elliot Smith and his all-loving, all-possessive daughter, Pamela. And you're behaving in exactly the same way now that you think somebody might be taking him away from you. Tom, I see you've got yourself nicely settled in.
I'm anxious to get started. I've asked Danny here to help me on the letter bomb case.
Oh, fine, fine. I wouldn't want to upset the top brass.
And what does that mean?
It means that you've been sent here on an assignment, and I assume that they know what they're doing.
And I assume exactly the same thing.
This is in relation to the party on Saturday night.
Look, I don't know who was drinking and who wasn't, but if the rest of them are balked and given warnings, it's not right that this what's-his-name Sergeant O'Reilly sneaks your daughter upstairs and then she evaporates. Doesn't set a good example for the others, does it?
No, I wouldn't think it does. Look, leave this with me, Mrs. Bond. I'll look into it.
Listen, how can you expect young people to respect the law if the law doesn't apply equally to everyone?
I'm sorry, I will look into it. It won't happen again, I assure you. Was Gail involved in some kind of incident here on Saturday night?
Oh, I'm sorry, Glenn. I had hoped you'd hear about that from Gail, because that was part of the deal.
The deal?
Oh, she didn't tell you anything.
Not a word.
Well, on Saturday night, a group of young people were brought in here after a complaint, a drunken disturbance at a party, and Gail was one of them. Naturally, she was worried about what you'd think. Well, she assured me she had nothing to do with the disturbance, and I believed her. So I booked a taxi to take her home, on the condition that she explained to you exactly what happened.
Well, she didn't.
No, I gathered that.
You realize how this looks, Eric, booking everyone except Gail?
Oh, no, I didn't book any of them. I just took their names and telephoned their parents. Look, I'm sorry, Glenn, if I did the wrong thing, but I was worried about the effect on you on the station.
You were wrong, Eric, and so was Gail.
Don't be too hard on him, Glenn. I mean, it's tough enough being a cop's kid. No offence, mate, but it's even tougher when he's a cop 24 hours a day, like you.
Don't you think I know that, Eric? You see a solicitor's clerk named Adams this afternoon?
Yes, I went to get the Garcia Slam transcripts. Why?
He's just been on the phone complaining. He said that you pushed your way around, used abusive language, generally behaved in a manner unbefitting a police officer. Those are very familiar words, aren't they?
Oh, come on. All I did was tell him what I wanted. I may have been a little firm with
him. Firm? According to him, you were rude and insulting. Can't you get through one day without treading on somebody's toes?
That is a load.
And you stink like a brewery. Have you been boozing again?
That's my business.
Now, look, I don't have to pretend that I'm happy with your transfer back here to Riverside. I have to go along with this assignment. But you get out of line just once and you are gone. Is that clear?
That is very clear.
Good. Foster! The hell's going on here?
We are interviewing a witness.
All right, Mr. Corley, you can go. I'm sorry you've been inconvenienced.
Keep out, Glenn. This is my case.
Yes, and you're handling it like a stormtrooper.
I'll handle it any damn way I please.
In my police station, you'll handle it according to established police procedure.
Established police procedure?
Foster!
Foster?
Oh, yeah.
Yes, all right, I'll be right around. Yeah. I'm leaving.
Foster, I'm talking to you.
You were. Well, if it isn't my beloved superior officer and friend. Sit down, beloved superior officer. Sit down, friend.
Tom, I'm taking you off the case.
Did you hear what I said? You're no longer on the case. It's not working out, mate.
What do you mean it's not working out? How would you know? You never give me a chance. You never give anybody
just
a chance.
Just keep your voice down.
I'm not going to take orders from a pompous ass like you. I don't need you.
Tom,
I don't need you either. I don't need the stinking police force.
Tom,
need
if you don't
job.
Shut up.
You are nothing but a headline-grabbing phony.
Sarge, stop it!
Right, oh, Foster, that just about wraps you up for good.
Tom, don't you be a fool. Aren't you in enough trouble already?
Sorry I hit you so hard, Glenn. A little out of practice.
No time for apologies. How'd we go?
Well, LaRouche got a good look at my act. I think he's bought it.
He better buy it. Anything else?
Yeah. They want Garcia, too. Little matter of a missing $250,000. I think I'm getting close to the top. How am I doing?
Until now, pretty good. Everybody in the station thinks you're bent, including Danny.
I was very annoyed by your response to my memo.
Why?
Because, Glenn, you and I know, and everybody over the age of eight knows, that this police station, your police station, Glenn, is right smack dab in the center of a circle of vice and corruption, probably unequalled in the rest of the country.
I don't need a geography.
The parlors, the dens, and the brothel. Look, 11 and 12-year-old kids, for God's sake. Filth and perversion, and obscenity, and monsters making millions.
I know all that.
You know all that, and yet you can't spare the time to get off your goddamn rear end and do something about it.
You knew his father?
Yes, I knew him. He battered an old man senseless during an armed robbery. He caved his skull in with the butt of a shotgun. There was a young constable involved. Hadn't been in the force very long. Saunders aimed the shotgun at the constable. The constable shot him.
Sarge, you're not suggesting just because his son has a polite surface that underneath he's as violent as his father, are you? Well, he didn't assault the other driver. I must admit, I would have been tempted. Look, you don't believe in all that hereditary behaviour stuff, do you, really?
No, I suppose not, but being nice to a copper wouldn't come easy, particularly if it was a copper who shot and killed your father.
Hey, look, you saw he's in there.
You just haven't got the right knock.
Yeah.
Just some more information on that hit run, Sarge.
Yes, the one in Grey Street.
Yeah, there are indications it could be more than that.
Like what?
Well, the lane that the vehicle apparently came out of, there are a couple of tyre marks burnt into the road surface. Looks like the car's motor was at full revs at takeoff.
You think they were waiting for him?
It's a possibility.
Now, who would want to kill Charles Carter, apart from 100 people he's ripped off in his land deals and the dozens of people he's walked on to get to where he was?
Well, I better check the most likely prospects then, hadn't I?
That would seem to be a normal course of action. Anything on the vehicle?
Oh, the usual confusion, but most likely a Holden, 63, 64.
What about the driver?
No description yet, but the way it was driven, the speed at which it was driven, would seem to indicate someone with skill, almost professional experience.
Well, that's something, I suppose.
Jeff and Mike are still there.
Then we'll wait until we hear from them.
Right.
You still want me to check those prospects, don't you?
Danny, do you want it in writing?
No.
Is that the information on those vehicles that I've been waiting for?
Oh, yes, Sarge asked me to bring it up.
Would it be too much trouble in future for you to do as you're told? I thought you had records to check.
I have, and I'm checking them, all right?
Why don't you expand your list of suspects to include everybody in Riverside who can drive a car?
Because the ones on Danny's list have a motive.
Look, I'll leave you lot to sort it out. I don't know who killed Carter, and to be brutally honest with you, I don't care. Whoever it was probably did the city a public service. I'm calling it a day. I'll see you tomorrow.
Well, well, two surprises in one day. First a phone call just to say hello, and now you're home early.
Do you think you could stand three surprises? What say we go out for dinner tonight, just the two of us?
Way ahead of you. I've got a beautiful meal all prepared. It's in the oven, just waiting to be switched on. Daddy's coming over, remember?
No.
Well, it's not that hard to do.
No, it's not that. Look, can you put him off just this once?
But, darling, the meal's all prepared and...
Well, don't switch it on.
But, well, what about Gail?
Look, surely it's not too much to ask just one night, just the two of us.
Oh, all right. I suppose I can ring Daddy and Gail's not entirely helpless.
Thank you.
What's the occasion?
It's no occasion. I just feel I've got to get away somewhere quiet, relax, unwind and talk.
All right.
Okay. I think I'll have a kip for about 10 minutes. It's been one of those days. And thank you for coming.
Oh, I'm usually available to be wined and dined, if the right man asks me. Glenn, what's the problem?
What would you say if I told you that I was thinking of resigning from the police force? Well, it's a pity, but the man has made a formal complaint. I'll just have to report it to B11.
Yeah, well, I confess I saw it in that light myself.
Let's hope they won't be too rough at all. Yeah.
Glenn, I just... Oh, sorry, I'll come back.
It's okay, Jeff. I'm just going anyway.
Oh. What is it, Jeff?
Well, I just wanted to say that Valerie's had a chat with Pamela and it's okay for dinner tomorrow night.
Pamela said that?
Yeah. Well, that is okay.
Yeah, sure.
Glenn, if for some reason you don't want to come and you're just using Pamela as an excuse, I'd rather know.
No, I'd love to be there, honestly. Pamela, this dinner party at the Johnsons.
Oh, yes?
You said we'd go.
Yes, I did.
Why?
I just didn't think I could get out of it.
Didn't you?
Not without letting Valerie know that we were splitting up.
Well, I'd already told Jeff that you'd made other plans. There was no need to say anything else.
Valerie just really seemed to want us to be there.
And that's the only reason you said yes?
I suppose so. I wondered
if you'd changed your mind.
Hello? Oh, hello, Valerie. No, there's no problems this end. Yes, we'll be there right on 8. All right, dear, looking forward to it. Bye-bye.
Pamela, I don't want to jump to conclusions, so I'd like to know.
Well, I haven't changed my mind. This thing with Malcolm is just something I've got to try.
That's your decision.
I'll have to tell Gail soon. I can't put that off much longer.
Yeah, I want to talk to her with you, remember?
Oh, yes, of course.
I think we'd better leave it until after tomorrow night. You could hardly expect a 15-year-old girl to go through a dinner party calmly knowing this.
Oh, no sense in hurting her until we have to.
No.
Still, she's young,
but
she'll...
Pamela, let's not talk about it anymore. We've agreed, right?
Oh, Jeff.
Oh, Glenn.
Well, you were expecting us, weren't you?
Come in.
Valerie?
Hi, Glenn.
Surprise! Malcolm was he born so beautiful?
Do you know about this?
Why was yes. he born at all?
That's why you can.
Because he had no say in it.
Thank you.
No say in it.
Come on, Glenn, come over here and have a drink. Come on.
Rule number one, Danny, never marry a policeman. Rule number two, if you do, don't complain about it.
Mrs. Peterson, do you have any idea where Neil might be?
Well, I haven't seen him since this morning. He's not a bad boy, Sergeant. He doesn't... He can't cope. Now Murray's after him.
Murray?
I have been trying to find a mentally disturbed young man who's already almost killed somebody. I couldn't just give it up.
Hey, you were doing that all night?
I was going to go. I came home, I sat down for 5 minutes, I just died.
Are you working on a case concerning the Grover Employment Agency?
No, Eric, we're not.
I thought not, mate. Well, I think you should know this. I reckon JJ's after a second job.
I will not have moonlighting, and JJ knows that.
Well, I think it's about time you reminded him again, don't you?
Don't you worry, Eric, I will.
Because it'll never happen with uniform boys. I always keep my fellas on a very tight rein.
Well, good for you, Eric. Take care of that, will you? Are you suggesting that he stole the money and then planted in your room?
Well, it could be him. He hates my guts.
Now, do you think he'd sacrifice $37,000 just to set you up?
Well, the money's covered by insurance. I mean, he hasn't lost a thing, has he?
He could have kept the cash and claimed the insurance. It doesn't wash, Lang. You stole that money.
No!
All right, Mike, charge him.
They dropped the charges.
Yes, they said they realised they'd made a mistake. Excellent news, isn't it, sir? I'm personally delighted for Gail's sake.
Yes, I've never known a store change its mind like that before.
No, they were most adamant at the time. It seems all our good words fell on deaf ears.
I wonder who supplied the hearing aid.
I beg your pardon, sir?
Nothing, Baker. Thank you for letting me know.
My pleasure, sir, and please tell your daughter how glad I am it all came to a happy conclusion.
Manager, please. Sergeant Taylor, over side CI. Mr. Lewis, is it? Sergeant Taylor, Riverside CI, you recently laid a charge of shoplifting against my daughter, Gail. Yes, I'd like to know why that charge has been withdrawn. My solicitor? Mr. Galbraith, well, yes, yes, I see. Thank you very much, Mr. Lewis.
Sorry I was out for a while earlier. Unavoidable.
Yes, where were you?
Appointment, sort of personal, you know.
With the Grover Employment Agency. Are you out for a job or something?
Who, me?
Who else?
Valerie, actually. She's been wanting to get back to work for a while.
And you won't let her. Besides, the appointment was for you.
Really been checking up on me, haven't you?
I will not have my men moonlighting, Jeff. You know that.
Everybody does it.
Not at my police station, and nobody's going to.
Hell, Glenn, I am up to my eyeballs in debt.
And you've got a co-op loan to cover those debts.
All right, I'm up to my eyeballs in loan repayments.
Stop exaggerating, Jeff. Everybody has debts. It's a sign of modern living.
Not all of us, mate. Some have rich wives to foot the bills. Sorry, I shouldn't have made that crack. I'm sorry.
Have a good day. Not so good, hey?
Mom, is it okay if I do my homework out? Hi, Dad.
I thought it'd be nice if we all went out to eat tonight.
Why, do we have something to celebrate?
No, not that I know of. I would have thought that
Mr. Galbraith would have reported back to you by now.
All right, Glenn. You know. Now, if you've got an honest bone in your body, you'll admit that you'll please Gail's off the hook.
I'm pleased Gail is off the hook.
Well.
Gail, go to your room.
But Mum only did it for me,
Dad. I said go to your room.
Yes, Dad.
Glenn, if we're going to have a shouting match, you'll hear anyway.
I'm not going to shout.
Oh, why argue about it at all?
If... for once, you had done things my way.
Gail might have been found guilty, Glenn. I couldn't take that chance.
Other people have to take that chance. Other people don't have that kind of influence to back them up.
I don't care about other people. I care about my daughter.
What about your husband? What about loyalty to him? Doesn't that matter anymore?
I haven't been disloyal to you. I don't know what you're talking
about. You can't see it, can you?
Glenn, look, I'm sorry that I went against your wishes, but I just felt I had to for Gail's sake. It was her welfare I was thinking about.
You really are your father's daughter, aren't you?
Oh, come on, Glenn. Leave Daddy out of it.
If only I could. If only we could keep him out of our lives.
He's not even in the country.
But he's still running our lives. And I've had enough, Pamela. More than enough.
Glenn?
Can I help you?
Yes, I'm Paul Reid, the new social worker.
If you'll take a seat, I'll see if I can find Mrs. Davidson.
No, waiting for Mrs. Davidson.
Well, you can't wait there.
You're absolutely right. I think I'll go and look for her.
Just a moment.
It's all right, it's all right. I'm sure I can find my own way.
You can't go wandering about either.
I will be working here. I'm Paul Reid.
You want to see me?
Beatrice Smith.
I've been called worse.
Thank you.
New coat of paint. New furniture. Same old story.
Sit down.
No, thanks. I'm pretty busy. Now, what can I do for you?
I take it you don't approve of people in my profession.
Well, now you do catch on quick. You get points for that.
Why don't you sit down and open your mind, if you can stand the draft?
Oh, a sense of humour too, eh? Well, that makes a change. You get points for that as well.
I won't beat about the bush.
Better and better.
I understand that you have some sort of influence with the women, that they look to you as a sort of spokesperson, which is why I want to see you. I want you to pass on a... declaration of policy, if I might call it that.
I'm listening.
I'm concerned with the women's welfare, which doesn't mean that I'm here to save souls or to wipe runny noses. However, if somebody has a genuine grievance, I will take whatever action I consider to be appropriate. For example, Pat O'Connell's attending her son's funeral, or Chrissy Latham being transferred back to the laundry.
No one's going to thank you for Latham.
I'm not here to win a popularity contest. I would also like to organize some kind of activity, something which will aid rehabilitation, or at least help to pass the time. There doesn't seem to be a great deal going on here.
Now, what did you have in mind?
Well, I thought I'd leave that up to you. I'm open to suggestions. There's no point starting something if nobody's going to be interested.
I'll ask around. Can't promise anything.
But you will try.
I said I'd ask. Oh, the name's B.
I'm really looking forward to being able to start studying again.
Good. Well, there's some of my son's textbooks. He won't be needing them any longer.
Oh, terrific. This should give me something to get my teeth into. Don't look like they've been used much. Didn't your son finish his studies?
No. And don't come the wall of silence treatment with me, pal. I'm not in the mood for it. You've been gone less than 48 hours and already I've got to come out and bail you out on drug charges.
Nobody asked you to. I didn't.
Oh, I see. So tomorrow you're going to face up to the court and take what's coming, right?
Wrong. Tomorrow I'm going to go into court and tell the truth about what happened, and hopefully I'll get the same benefit of the doubt that you'd give any one of your crims.
The doubt being that it's your word against the police.
Yeah, it looks like that.
You were in the house when it was busted.
Well, yeah, but...
All right, tell me about it.
There's nothing to tell. We're just sitting around.
You were just sitting around.
There was nothing else
to do. All right. You were sitting around. Then what happened?
When this Sharon Bird comes in. I'd never met her before, and... Well, I was introduced to her, and then she started talking to a couple of
guys.
I don't know. I wasn't listening.
What happened then?
Well, then there were cops coming from everywhere, yelling something about being busted. I didn't know what they were talking about. You don't believe me, do you? Even if I swore on a stack of Bibles, you wouldn't believe me.
I believe you.
Well, then why the third degree?
That's tame to what you could come up against in court tomorrow. It's all very well for me to accept your explanations of what happened. It's the magistrate we've got to convince. Hello, Miss Bennett.
Oh, good afternoon, Mr. Reid. I'm afraid I owe you an apology.
Huh?
I've been telling everyone that you were employed here full time.
I understand we had three new admissions last night. Do we have files on them?
Yes, they're in the filing cabinet where they're usually kept. You'll find them under new admissions. That drawer?
There's only two here, Simpson and Williams.
Oh, I'm afraid I owe you another apology, Mr. Reid. Sharon Gilmore, just been bringing it up to date.
Thank you. Come in.
Mr. Reid, Sharon Gilmore to see you.
Good. Oh, come in, please, sit down. And thank you, Miss Bennett.
I'll wait for her outside.
Well, you don't mind if I call you Sharon, do you?
Please yourself.
Good. My name is Paul Reid.
I know who you are and what you are.
Fine, then you'll know that my job is to help people like yourself.
You're going to help me, all right, Mr. Reid. You're a man of influence, aren't you?
Well, I'm not too sure.
Of course you are. Then you're going to influence me right out of this bloody place.
I'm sorry, I don't quite follow you.
Come on, Mr. Reid. You've got my file there. And I'm sure you must be very familiar with my case. So let's talk about how you're going to get me off the hook.
Well, I'm afraid it's not quite that easy, Sharon.
Make it easy, Mr. Reid. Because if you don't, I'm going to make it damned hard on you and your son, Tony, when they put me in that witness box. And I don't think Tony will enjoy Pentridge any more than I enjoy this place, do you?
Oh, sorry, I wasn't here earlier. My business took longer than expected.
Sit down, please, Mr. Reid.
Thank you. Now, about this radio station,
That's not what I wanted to see you about.
Oh.
I do try to make it a rule not to pry into the personal lives of my staff. But when the integrity of the prison authority is concerned, I have to make inquiries.
Yes, of course.
From information I have received, it would appear that you have not only withheld information from the police, but you have used your influence to have your son released from a very serious charge.
Sharon Gilmore didn't waste any time, did she?
It was, in fact, a member of staff who brought it to my notice.
Oh, I see. Well, I'm sorry if you've had your time wasted on this.
I do regard this allegation in a very serious light.
Yes, of course you do, and so do I. I knew nothing about this matter until I heard Sharon Gilmore's story. I chose to believe my son wouldn't lie to me. A mistake, as I now know. I went and saw my son. He realized his mistake, and he went to the police and made a clean breast of it.
I see.
I realize how suspicious it must have looked, and one could hardly blame Vera for jumping to conclusions.
I didn't mention Vera.
I've got a fair idea of whose toes I stand on around here.
Well, if this story gets around, as it is bound to, I would rather it wasn't the distorted version. I shall speak to her about it.
Oh, Pat, I've been looking for you. Could I see you in my office for a couple of minutes, please?
It's nearly lunchtime.
Can't you get somebody else to do all this?
Well, you'd have to fix it with Miss Bennett. What do you want?
It's about your children. Well, actually, it's Andrew.
What about him?
I had a call from the department. He's in trouble again. I thought you might like to go and see him.
No.
Why not?
Make him worse.
It doesn't necessarily follow, Pat.
Look, last time he saw me here, he ran away from home. Seeing me only upsets him.
I wish you'd reconsider.
That's the lunch bell.
All right, I'll talk to you later.
No, I don't want to talk. I don't want to see them. In 18 months, when I'm out of here, that's when I want to see them. Until then, they'll manage.
O'Connell?
Yes, Miss Bennett?
You'll need to get another plate. Latham's in a cell. Apparently, she's not feeling well.
Well, Pat, there is something else I want to talk to you about, so I will see you later on.
No, thanks. I've decided.
Well, I'm sure you'll be able to work it out between the pair of you.
Yeah, I know we will. Because as far as I'm concerned, Tony's future comes first. And if that means I have to make sacrifices, then I'll make them.
How much are you prepared to sacrifice?
Meg, as I see it, he's got his whole future ahead of him. He's got to get it right.
You still haven't answered my question. If you have to, how much are you prepared to sacrifice?
If I have to... everything. Oh, Mrs. Davidson.
Yes, Mr. Reid.
I'll be taking a couple of hours off this afternoon if you've no objections.
And if I have?
Well, that could make things rather difficult. You see, my son is being released from the prison farm today, and I'd like to be at the station to...
Oh, of course. Take all the time you need.
Thank you so much. Morning, Miss Bennett.
Introduce you to some of the farmers outside of town.
Listen, I'll be battling to remember half the people we met this morning.
Oh, that's okay. They'll remember you. It's important for a country policeman to become part of the community. I reckon it's the biggest part of the job.
Yeah, well, you wouldn't get much heavy crime, would you?
Well, when you know the people, you can cut off most of it before it happens. We get the odd domestic, traffic offences. I suppose the biggest problem is stock thefts.
How's that?
Well, nothing major. But you know how it is. A bloke starts out shooting rabbits on private property. One day he goes out, he doesn't get any, so he knocks over a sheep instead.
I suppose the perks would be pretty good too, then.
Well, we don't get a lot of overtime.
No. I mean perks. All these grateful farmers. You wouldn't have to go rushing around to get fresh meat and vegetables, would you?
No fear. I discourage that sort of thing. Well, people would like to be generous, but once it starts, it's hard to know where to draw the line. It starts out as a dozen eggs, as a favour. The next thing you know, someone's offering you a bribe. The whole chook.
Kids are going through exams at the moment. You don't want to upset them at this time of the year.
No, you've got to think of that sort of thing when you've got a couple of... Hey, hang on.
What?
That bloke there. He's on private property. It's the sort of thing I was telling you about. Good day, Steve.
Hi, Frank.
Okay, up against the car.
What?
Come on, get up against the car.
What?
Come on, do it properly, you know the system.
Hey, wait a minute, Perry.
Spread him.
What's this? We've got you, haven't we?
Wouldn't do that.
No, Perry, not the pocket.
Wait. Get it off. Go. Get it off.
It's only a ferret.
Well, get it off me.
It's a ferret. That's all.
Oh, no!
Plenty more like Nolan where we're going to.
That's what I mean. If you give him trouble, he might, I don't know, warn them or something.
Oh, I'm not some big-time criminal, nothing, darling.
Well, I know that. Well, is he going to charge you with trespassing or whatever it was he said you were doing? He can't charge you, can he?
He can do what he likes. What do you want?
You told me I had to report here.
Oh, yeah, that's right. You're on private property. That's trespassing. That's an offence. I'm going to give you an official warning. Next time, I'll charge you.
Is that it?
That's it.
I wasn't trespassing. I had permission to be there. I know those people.
Yes, and I know you and hundreds like you. Any more back chat and you're gone. Understand that?
You're not in the city now, Nolan. If you're looking for a payoff, you're not going to get it. I can't afford it.
Who said anything about a payoff?
I know people like you too. Hundreds like you.
You hold on to him. This will get him out.
Let's have a look at him. Let's have a look at him. And you're still with us, huh? Okay, leave him where he is.
What?
I said leave him where he is.
Listen, mate, I know...
Leave him where he is! You touch that jack and I'll wrap it round your bloody skull! In a bit of a hurry, are we?
I was doing just under 80.
Oh, you were doing more than that.
Oh, come off it. I know this road like the back of my hand. The speed limit's 80, and that's what I was doing.
You're doing closer to 90.
What? You want to get your speedometer checked.
Your word against mine, pal. See, you've got a couple of bald tires on the front. Bit of rust. And I'd fancy your chances when it comes to getting this re-registered, you know?
The tires aren't that bad. And this old bus gets me there and back.
You're an argumentative sort of a bloke, aren't you? Give us a look at your license.
If you're looking for handouts, you're too late. I coughed up to the other bloke. You ought to get organised, Frank. He got in first. I hope he's going to give you your heart.
What are you talking about?
I gotta help.
I need to talk to you, Perry.
Yeah, sure. What's the matter?
Well, let's start with your outstanding account at the club.
Yeah, what about it?
You haven't paid for anything yet.
So?
We don't do things like that up here.
All right, I'll take care of it.
I'd appreciate it if you settled up with Cookie tonight.
I said I'd take care of it.
Would you like to tell me what happened between you and Mr. Pearson?
Pearson?
You pulled him over for alleged speeding.
Oh, yeah, alleged? Hey, what's he been telling you?
I'd like to hear your version.
Well, he was speeding and he had two bald tires.
He alleged he paid you money.
Oh, come off it, Frank. I'm not going to risk my career for 20 lousy bucks.
He didn't say how much.
He said he wasn't speeding. That's his word against mine, isn't it?
That man has a good reputation in this district.
Oh.
Come on, Frank, you don't know what's going on up here. You're a country copper born here. I'm not. And they're out to get me.
Oh, come off it.
Listen, Frank, I am telling you, the boys in town warned me, and they know. Country people are prejudiced.
I can't believe Pearson would say he paid you money if he hadn't.
Then you don't know your own people as well as you thought. Listen, Frank, we've got to stick together. It's us against them. That's the game we're in. So we close ranks, right? They pick on one, they pick on all of us, right?
Good day.
Hey, Cookie, come here. Frank tells me that you're wanting to settle up my account.
Yeah, well, it is getting a bit high, and we don't usually give credit to non-members.
Oh, well, let's say that I appreciate your making an exception.
Well, I haven't got a title yet.
Give us a look. I reckon we can work something out, Cookie.
Well, I reckon we can. I'll add it up, tell you how much it is, and you buy it.
Listen, mate, I know you've got to talk money with members, but when we're in a position to help one another, do each other favors...
The only favor I want is the money for that Jack and Jill.
Okay, if that's the way you want to play.
I'm not playing, mate. I don't play games.
No problems.
And from now on, I'd like you to pay as we go. You know, rule to rule.
Okay. Whose dog?
It's mine.
I suppose you know that dogs aren't permitted on these premises?
Carpenter is.
Rules are rules, mate. Ask Cookie.
No way am I leaving Carpenter outside. Where I go, he goes.
Dogs are not permitted on these premises. It's against the health department regulations. It could attract a very heavy fine.
You better take him out, Beth.
Warden.
I'm sorry.
Ah, come on, boy. Let's get out of here. A miserable old sod.
Usual thanks.
I want to talk to you.
Oh, really? What about?
This drunk driving business with Cookie.
Yeah, what's the trouble?
The trouble is you set him up. The whole town knows it.
So? Well, maybe they'll be more careful in future before they drink and drive. Most of the serious accidents happen in the country. Or do you like having a bunch of drunks charging around your roads?
That's something I've been dealing with for years.
Oh, yeah? How many fines? How many suspensions?
You still set him up. You drank with them, bought them drinks, pretended to be their mate.
A policeman doesn't have any mates. You should know that. The only mate a policeman's got is another policeman.
I'm not getting through to you, that's obvious. So here's the new arrangements. Whenever the police car goes out, I'll be in it. You'll spend most of your time here at the station. The only time you'll be going out on duty is with me.
Sounds cozy.
Yeah.
Well, we really got the deep freeze treatment yesterday, didn't we?
Listen, I've always done very well in Wandon Valley, just like my father before me.
It's a pity you didn't have a son. He could have kept up the dynasty.
And the thing about a cop in a small country town, you don't make a big parade of yourself. You don't swagger up and down the street, and you don't get heavy with the locals. But every now and then you're needed, and sometimes you're really needed.
Oh, just like Pollyanna, huh? Forget it, Frank. Nobody likes a copper. So you're in it for what you can get out of it.
Like Judy Loveday?
Judy is just a bit of fun, as far as I'm concerned.
I wonder if your wife would think of it that way. Can't be much fun for her, keeping a house together, bringing up a couple of kids while you're gone.
Why don't you mind your own damn business?
Hey, Frank, I'm a bit worried.
What's the problem, Bert?
Well, I was on my way to the vets, and I called in to see old Mrs. Bailey. She usually makes me some scones, you know. Got a lovely light touch for scones, but not a sign of her to be seen anywhere. Blinds were drawn. Milk still out on the front veranda. Lady next door hadn't seen her either.
Right, we'll come out and have a look with you, Bert.
We?
Yes, we.
Oh, yeah, just in case the old lady's got a deadly weapon, huh?
So that I can keep an eye on you. Come on, Bert. Give us a pen, will you?
Yeah.
What's that?
What? Nothing. Why?
Turn out your pockets. That's an order. You robbed a dead woman?
Oh, come on, Frank. It's not worth that much. She's got no further use for it, has she? There's a present for sure.
You're suspended from duty.
You can't do that.
Oh, yes, I can. On the authority of Superintendent Burke of Barragan, who's been kept informed of what's been going on here. Now, there'll be two internal affairs men here at 8 o'clock in the morning. You better be here, on the knocker.
You put me in?
You really don't understand, do you? You've been using your position in this town for your own ends. You're a disgrace to that uniform. Now, get the hell out of my sight!
Your word against mine.
Oh, no, it's not. We'll both see internal affairs, and it'll be your record against mine, and I'll state my record against yours any day.
In that case, I will not be joining you.
Mike.
No, not if Evelina's going to be here. I like to enjoy my Christmas, Elizabeth. With that woman around, that will certainly not be possible.
We can't be too hard on Evelina, Mike. Please, as a special favor to me.
You are making this extremely difficult for me.
Oh, Mike, it wouldn't be Christmas without you.
I hope you realize that I wouldn't do this for anybody else.
You're sweet.
Yes, I know. But I don't think you'll be persuading Clem quite as easily. He knows Evelina every bit as well as I do. It's my son. He's had a seizure, a bad one.
A seizure?
Yeah, he's epileptic. He hasn't had a fit in years. It was frightening. I didn't know what to do, so I called an ambulance.
How's he doing?
Well, I don't know. He's been in there forever, and nobody's telling me anything.
Look, it's okay. Your son...
Yeah, Eric.
Eric, yeah, he's about 14?
Yeah.
And is he taking medication?
Yes, he always takes his medication. Obviously, it's not working, or he's getting worse.
It could be any number of things.
So why is it taking so long? A few simple tests is what they say.
They're very thorough here. It doesn't mean to say that there's any complications. I'll just go and see if I can find out what's going on.
Thank you.
I've increased Eric's medication. That should control the seizures from now on.
She's okay.
He's fine. You can take him home.
Good, thank you, Doc.
Thanks, Amelia. Good news. Must be relieved.
Should control the seizures. It didn't control the seizure this time, did it?
Tom, Eric's turned from a boy into a young man since those pills were prescribed. He just needs to be upgraded.
So how does she know that the new medication's going to make any difference at all?
Well, she doesn't, for sure. There's no hard and fast rules with epilepsy. I'd say if he hasn't had a repeat seizure by now, there's an extremely low risk of it happening again.
You feeling it?
Yes. So stop worrying. I wasn't going to have to admit you.
Yeah. Okay.
Good. Now, you've been told, so get in there and see your son.
Yeah. Right. Oh, look. Thank you very much.
Oh, don't be silly. Just doing my job.
No, I mean it. You've been a very good friend.
Thank you.